Hello.
Whoa.
That's scary, right?
One, two, three,
welcome
four.
To Rutgers. Thank you so much for coming tonight, right? Everybody here for all these physics demos. What? How exciting is that?
Put that back.
That's great.
Put that back there for Maiullo when you get a chance.
I'll turn this down a little bit.
One, two, three. Am I on there too?
You should be on there too.
Oh, that's...
Yeah. It's got to be up here.
Yeah.
That's where your mouth is. These things. He's a professor.
Oh. I thought you were going
to... You want me to start?
Yeah, you start off.
Dave Maiullo from the Rutgers Department of Physics and Astronomy, and it is a physics and astronomy, great astronomy program here too. Thank you so much for spending your Friday night with us, because this is should be a lot of fun for all of us if we survive, okay? We may not, but you'll survive, I know that. Before we get started with the demonstrations, the first thing we always like to do with these shows is thank our wonderful crew, and I think you might agree with me, they have a wonderful crew of people out here manning those demonstrations. Right. Our Rutgers students shine in this way. They give me hope for the future. I hope they give you hope for the future too, okay? Remember them, all right? Because they're the reason we can do this. Mark?
Okay. Thanks for coming to the 17th Faraday Show here at Rutgers. And what we do is we do the lecture demonstrations we use in the regular lectures for teaching the students so that they don't get so bored they fall out of their chairs. But we ham it up a little bit. And hopefully you'll have some fun tonight.
Check this. Yeah.
And also learn a little bit of physics and something to think about for the future. We found that the students tend to like, of course, informative demonstrations, but they usually like something that embarrasses the professor. Humiliate the professor. One is the most popular. It hasn't happened yet, but we're still trying. Okay, so we're going to start off with matter in motion, and the first of Newton's laws on the couch. Effect. I get on the couch and I end up on the couch. And I stay there and you can't get me off. Here I have a series of objects that are at rest. And there's a little more in this demonstration than just the part we talk about. There's some friction in here too. But these objects are at rest and they tend to stay at rest. And because of the law of inertia, I'll leave them on. I should not have to buy a pair of new glasses after this. Also in Newton's law of inertia is that objects in motion tend to stay in motion. And this is something that Aristotle didn't get right at all. He said to keep an object in motion, he had to continuously push on it. But that's because poor old Aristotle didn't have air hockey pucks. And so if I give it a little push, it travels in a straight line at a constant speed unless interrupted by something else. So that's an object in motion tends to stay in uniform motion. That's the law of inertia. The next of Newton's law is Newton's second law. And I'll get to the part where I might get killed later. Never fear. And that's F equals ma, force equals mass times acceleration. Or in other words, an object has a certain property we call mass, you and I would call how heavy it is, if it's heavy, it doesn't move easily. If it's light, it moves very easily. So here's a very light object. And so if I put a force on him, he goes flying off and startles people in the first row. Here I have a little heavier object, and I put the same force on this guy, and he doesn't make it to the front row. You were worried, right? And here I have a third guy, and he's a lead brick. And I can beat on him quite hard, and he doesn't like to accelerate at all because he has a very heavy mass. I can even put him on my hand and beat on my hand, and he won't move much. And it doesn't hurt at all. Magnets are also fun. These are called buzz magnets. You can get them on the internet. They're really quite powerful magnets, and they're not terribly dangerous. They're called buzz magnets. If you do this little trick, they buzz for you. But they illustrate, if you put them close to each other, one of the most important of the things Newton found out about from people that studied magnetism, that is action at a distance. They can have a force on each other even though they don't touch each other. And so I'll bring them a little closer, and they snap together. Okay, so that's, but you can have a lot of fun with this. Okay, so those are the buzz magnets.
Why don't I do this one right here, right?
Okay.
Does everybody recognize what this is? Bowling ball. Are bowling balls massive? Everybody knows how to bowl, right? You take one of these, you throw it down the lane, right? And they're nice and big and heavy. What's it attached to? A little string, right? Is it a thick string? No, it's not a thick string. Can I lift this bowling ball with this light string? Yes, no, man. That's, you sound just like the people next door in that ivory tower we got, and they argue all the time. They sound just like that. Yes, no, maybe. So what do they have to do to find out? An experiment, a testing experiment. So this is a heavy bowling ball, a light string, and if my theory is correct, I can actually lift this up off the floor. So let's see if I can do that. So I pull slowly, and yeah, this string is strong enough to support the weight of that, the mass of that bowling ball. If I move the bowling ball slowly, it still supports it. What could I do to overwhelm the string? What do you think? What do you think?
Move it fast.
And we all kind of know this. We've all kind of tried. In fact, we probably do this a couple times a day. You don't realize it maybe, but you do. So here's my bowling ball in our experiment. Our theory is that if I move this fast, remember force is equal to mass times acceleration. Higher acceleration, move it faster, and it breaks every time. Now, when do you do that experiment? When do you do that experiment? I bet you know. When do you do that experiment? In the bathroom. That's right, because what's that? Toilet paper. And when you want some squares, how do you pull it? Slowly. But when you got enough squares, what do? It's the exact same experiment. All right? But don't support a bowling ball with this stuff. It won't work. All right? Oh, we'll leave this right here. There you go. Now, Mark's got another experiment to show us.
Okay. This is the a sleeper of an experiment. This is the force-reaction force. It's a you push me, I'll push you just as hard, but no harder, and in the opposite direction law, the force-reaction force law. And for this, the nice thing that Newton did was he partitioned the whole universe into just two parts, A and B, and A pushes on B, and B pushes back on A. Well, here is part of the universe. Are you buying stronger balloons as I go?
Yeah.
I knew it.
Okay. We're not going to need it.
This is a two-part system. The air in the balloon and the balloon. And if I let go of here, you know what's going to happen, right? The air is going to get shot in one direction, and the balloon's going to get pushed in the other direction.
Okay.
Well, the students tend not to like that so much as when a professor is endangered. And I don't know if I introduced myself. I'm Professor Mark Croft. Where the only important thing there is that when I do some of the demonstrations, you know, I'm expendable. We've got lots of professors. We've only got one Dave. And this is my old college football helmet, and it has a crack in it. Some people says it explains a lot of my behavior since then. And I'm going to take my glasses off here. Yeah. But it's different every year because I get a year older. I am 67, and I do have a titanium knee. And I'm going to have another one before one of these days. Okay, are we clear over there?
We're
and
good,
you're mopped
right?
up outside?
We're good.
All right, I'm going to shoot high-pressure CO2 in one direction, and it should shoot me in the other direction. Oh, God. Have we got more powerful ones? okay. Good. Do we have another one?
Oh, yeah. We got another one?
Okay.
Let's try it again. Bring out the other one. Did that actually run out on you? No. Bring out the other one. Bring out the other one.
I have a little story that goes with this.
Yeah.
We're going to get one that does the real deal.
That was empty.
That one was stored towards its end of its life.
Yeah, it was empty.
Maybe like something I also know.
Whoever tested it is good.
The first time I ever did that experiment, I was much younger, and I had a 50-pound fire extinguisher and a little teeny fire extinguisher I got up on a table to get the friction off. I had old skates. And at that time, let's see, I discovered the following. I found out that if you don't hold it in the very strange way that I hold it there, let me see if I can pull this guy down. Pull him over. Right here. Maybe I'll have to show it to you later. I was planning on having a little more time to set this up. So let me do the demonstration good now, or well. This is now a fully loaded one.
We hope.
Well, I don't mind if it's not fully loaded. Here we go. I thought, yeah.
Okay.
What I discovered when I did that, I blew myself on. You don't hold it shooting between your legs, you hold it off to the side, it puts you into rotation. And I blew myself off the table, rotating and translating. Okay, Dave, now you can pick up.
Let's bring that on over. So, we just saw an example of action-reaction. We're just going to backtrack for a second. What we have here, and you can plug that in, okay? Three soda cans on one side of this long tube. Here's our long tube. On the other side, we have some Mylar attached right here. We have some Mylar over on the other side right here. Here is a vacuum pump. We're going to pull all the air out of this tube right now. Then we're going to let all the air back in. Is it all plugged in? Yeah, looks like it's going to work. Sometimes it goes off early, but we're going to just let it pull right down. And here I have a hunting arrow, which is going to puncture this tube. Now, what's inside here is a ping pong ball. When the air comes back into this tube, it's going to push on that ping pong ball, go wrestling right down that long tube into those soda cans. Ping pong ball is just a small, thin piece of plastic. The soda cans are made of what? Metal. Pretty solid. Ping pong ball is not solid if you've ever played ping pong. So let's actually find out if F is equal to MA, because this ping pong ball should go up to about 700 miles per hour. Yeah. It's also a very loud noise. We try to tell you when we have loud noises in the show, and this is one of them. One, two, three. I don't think we made it to three. But we did get to two. If we go ahead and take this out, there's a hole in a soda can. Yeah. And a nice large dent in the other soda can. We didn't quite make it to three today, but it did go pretty far. Now we can play ping pong. Anybody? No? Here you go. Just get hit by the brick. Here you go. All right, now we just want to take that off. You got a little rest? You're good?
Okay. That was a bunch of things that moved in a straight line. But one of the most common things in physics in our universe is things that move sort of in circular motion. And I always like this guy because he illustrates to make something go in circular motion, I have to pull on a string. All I can do is pull with the string. In other words, if I go like that, it doesn't move there. It doesn't go like that, or like that, or like that. It doesn't go like that. But when I pull on it, it pulls towards the center. And if I swing it around now, I pull always towards the center, and it moves in what we call uniform circular motion. And if I let go of it, it goes into uniform motion because there's no force on it. It goes in a straight line. That's the David and... I'm sorry about that. Okay, now this is another force equals mass times acceleration.
He doesn't actually get this unless he gets the experiment right. So now let's see. I know he's thirsty, too.
Yeah, I am thirsty. Okay. Now.
Make sure you step away from there.
When you come to these shows, you shouldn't sit in the front row. You know why they like me to do this experiment? Because I'm not very good at it. If I swing this at high enough speed, I should be able to swing it around in a circle instead of it dumping on me and the guys in the first row. Well, let's see. There's only one problem. I don't know how to stop. Okay.
Yeah.
Don't take that away. I may need another shot. Okay. Now we're ready to start thinking about energy. And I can show you a couple simulations here while we're setting up the, thank you very much. I always need the help of the audience to let me know where my head is. Okay, it's on my head still? Okay. We're now going to talk about energy of motion and energy of position and the transfer of energy in between the two. Oh, 1 second. I am going to do springs and I am going to do a pendulum. We'll start off, however, with just a lacrosse ball. And you know, if I throw this at you, it could hurt, right? Or if you play baseball and you get hit by a pitched baseball, it hurts. As a matter of fact, that brings us to a word of caution. If you ever play Little League and there's an inside pitch and it's headed towards your body, you step back with your shoulder always towards the ball. You never dodge back like this and open up your center of your chest to a pitched baseball. It hits you in the center of the chest at the right part of your heartbeat, and it can make it stop. Okay? It's rare, but possible. Okay, so always keep your shoulder to the pitcher. At any rate, here's a lacrosse ball. If I throw it, it has energy of motion. If I drop it, when it hits the floor, it has energy of motion. Where did it get that energy of motion from? I didn't throw it. Gravity, of course. The Earth is pulling it downward. And so that means it has a certain energy of position simply by how high it is.
Back.
And that energy of position can be changed into motional energy simply by letting gravity take over. By holding it higher, it has a higher velocity when it gets to back. Now, the point of this now is that the sum of the two energies is always the same. And where do I have, is there a laser here?
There's lasers everywhere.
Laser pointer? Not a lightsaber laser, just a laser. Okay, that's okay. You can see these pendulum over here. Here is a pendulum. If I start it at a given height, it always comes back to the same height. So it is energy of position at the top and energy of motion at the bottom. Similarly with this one. Here I have springs, and the energy goes into compression of the spring and extension of the spring. So that's how you store energy, energy of position in a spring, and the energy of motion you can see in the motion. Now, I said the sum total of all of the energy has to stay the same. So if I start all... Oh, we've got a better ladder. Our old ladder used to be really... Oh, you've got to get the...
Yeah.
Oh. If I started out at a certain height, it should never be able to get to any higher point because the energy goes back to zero when it gets to its highest position.
The ball that Mark is holding right now is about 6 kilograms or so, which is very heavy. Okay, we're talking about, I don't know, about 12, 15 pounds. Down here at the bottom is a cinder block. That's at the bottom of its swing. So that's where all the energy is going to be what, Mark?
What?
What kind of energy will we get at the bottom?
We're going to have energy of motion, it's going to turn into energy of destruction.
And right now he's got it right against his nose, so let's see how much net energy it has.
And now I can confidently hold this up
Someone
against my nose, and it will come back and crush my nose because it can only come to zero energy of motion when it gets back to the same potential energy, same height. And so I let go of it, and I'm so confident I don't have to worry one bit. I'm absolutely confident! Okay.
Excellent.
They can fix my nose, but they can't fix my glasses as easily. Okay, where are we up to? So we talked about energy of motion and energy of position. And I think I'll take another drink. Spring and a weight. You're going to put it back on there?
Yeah, coming right up.
Again, the laser. I want you to notice that the energy goes back to characteristic time. Block. This one goes. And this one goes tick, 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 and this one goes tick, tick, tick. That's because one of them has more mass here, and it's because one of them has a longer length. Now, it so happens that this natural frequency on it in some way, the same frequency it likes to vibrate. So this likes to go boom. when I saw it. This is a glow-in-the-dark toilet seat. Okay, you got it? Am I hooked? Oh, did it pull out? Okay. And glow-in-the-dark stuff can also be fun, because you can also humiliate professors with it. No, not that one.
Point towards them. There you go.
Okay. Is it there?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Now, if you all got your glasses, your diffraction grating glasses, okay, let's start with, if you see this light right here, can you all see it? Look at it through your glasses. What do you see?
Rainbow.
A rainbow. Roy G. Biv. Red, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. Okay, or Richard of York gave battle in vain, if you like history. And so if you turn it down, turn it down to very low temperature. If the bulb has a very low temperature, there it goes disappearing. Which end is disappearing? The violet end. That's right. It still has red and green. That's a little bit more, Dave. Up, back. Oh, no. There we go. You see it's green and red. That's a low temperature light. And now turn it all the way up. That's a high temperature light, lots of blue. So you can tell the temperature of an object simply by looking at it through seeing how bright it is, or looking at it with the diffraction grating, what kind of light it has. Now, which one have we got? Actually, this is true for stars also. Yeah, this one's great. This is the Orion constellation. And if you would look at it in the night sky in January, it'll be someplace over here, just after sunset. And you can tell it because it has these three belt stars. And then it has this red star up in the top, which is, interestingly enough, is called Betelgeuse. And you notice something interesting about Betelgeuse? What color is he? Red. That's because he's a low-temperature red giant star. He's very bright because he's big, and he's red because he's cold, about 3,000 degrees Kelvin, and you can see his spectrum is mostly in the red. The belt stars are hot blue stars, or Rigel down here on the bottom. That's about 11,000 degrees, and it has almost no red. It's almost all in the violet, and then goes all the way into the ultraviolet. And if you extrapolate down towards the horizon, you see the brightest star in the sky, and that would be extrapolating down in this direction towards the horizon. That's Sirius. That's the brightest star in the sky. So now you can do a bad astronomy joke. And so you say something, and you say, are you Sirius? You say, no, Sirius is the brightest star in the sky. Okay. There is also a very interesting thing in the sword of Orion. Dangling from the belt here is the sword of Orion. In the middle of the belt, there is a glowing, hot hydrogen cloud. And when you look at that through a diffraction grating, look at what you see. Very specific colors, only specific colors. And those are the signatures of hydrogens. And now we can do that for you here, too.
Use those glasses again.
Look at this one right here. You see the red? That I've moved behind it. That red, can the people over here see? Okay. That red is the red Balmer line of hydrogen. That is a glowing hydrogen tube. And you can also see the violet. Now turn on the, now let's go to helium. See helium, the next one? You see that one? What's the most prominent one for helium? Yellow, that nice yellow. Remember that, we'll come back to it. What else do we have?
We have some mercury.
Okay, there's mercury. Very nice. Each element has its own lines, and you can tell it from another.
It's
just
like a fingerprint.
By heating it up.
Like a fingerprint.
It's like a fingerprint. Now, that's argon.
No, this is neon.
Oh, neon, I'm sorry. This is neon. And now we're going to turn on a fluorescent, compact fluorescent light bulb.
Now, you know how this looked. You saw all the different lines. You saw a full rainbow. Well, look at how a fluorescent light bulb, the CFLs, look. A little different, isn't it? You see a lot of little light bulbs now instead of the lines like the full, that full spectrum that we had before. Let's turn on the mercury underneath. And you'll see that a lot of those lines actually line up.
You see those lines line up with the lines of mercury.
Because there is mercury in those bulbs.
That's why you have to be careful in disposing of them.
Exactly right. Exactly right. Fantastic. Those glasses are for our present to you. Please do me one favor and don't look at the sun. Never look at the sun, okay? Never do that. However, those glasses you can use around the house, okay? If you have any kind of holiday lights up, go ahead and look at the lights, the holiday lights with those glasses. It's a lot of fun. Go ahead and, here, I'll get that back. That's it. Good.
Okay. There you can see the picture of the compact fluorescence. And here, back in 1850, in 1850, there was an eclipse of the sun. And they looked at the chromosphere, around the sun, and it had glowing lines in it. And you see this spectrum right here? Helium. Remember that yellow line you saw? It was first seen at an eclipse of the sun, a total eclipse of the sun, in 1850. Helium, the element helium that's in balloons, was not discovered on the surface of the Earth. It was discovered in the atmosphere of the sun first, and later on they looked for it here on the Earth.
Well, we'll get back into, we'll talk a little bit more about helium later, too. But let's go ahead and move on to a few things about density. And I'm going to do an experiment right here. What's that?
Water,
that's right, that's just water. And what I have here is what kind of soda?
Pepsi.
Pepsi, regular Pepsi. What kind of soda?
Diet Pepsi.
And this water bath here has a certain density. So, which weighs more? Right? Because they're the same size, right? So, will this sink or float? Just like before, everybody's arguing about this. That's okay. Will this sink or float? What do we got to do? The experiment. So let's go ahead and put it inside. And the Pepsi sinks. So of course this is going to... Why would this float if that sinks? Because it's diet. I love that. I love that. Because it does float. Now, why does regular Pepsi float, sink, and Diet Pepsi float? Yes. Sugar. Wrong.
He's really
why?
Nice, isn't he?
Huh? Density. Well, we know that. But why?
What makes
it
more
it's
dense?
Not just knowing. It's actually figuring out the actual thing. So, let's think about it. This is sweetened with what? Corn syrup. Now that they're putting corn syrup in your car, what's going to happen is corn syrup's going to get too expensive, and it'll go back and it'll start using sugar. But they haven't used sugar in regular soda for a long time. Okay, it's corn syrup. But they need a lot of corn syrup to make it sweet and sweet enough for us to want it. This is sweetened with rat poison. I mean NutraSweet. That's right. When they were looking for a rat poison, they used NutraSweet first. Now they said, well, no, it doesn't really work on the rats, but we'll put it in soda. Think about that. But you only need a little bit of it to make it as sweet as all that corn syrup. So the density is actually less in a diet soda. Now, we live here next to the Jersey Shore. Who's ever been in the ocean? Right. Who's ever been in a swimming pool? Most of us, right? Where do you feel more of a buoyant force, in the ocean or a swimming pool? Why? The salt, the toilet paper, the hype? No, I'm just kidding again. If we go ahead and we put salt in this water, you'll actually see that soda come right to the top. So now we've changed the density of the solution it's floating in. Now that comes to the top. So it's all about how one thing is relative to another. What floats in our atmosphere? What floats in our atmosphere? If you had a birthday and mom and dad come home and they said, I got something for you, you might expect getting some of these. What are these? Balloons. They float in our atmosphere. And the blue one over here actually floats pretty well, but the red ones over here float a lot better. Because the blue one over here has what kind of gas in it to make it float? Helium. And as we just heard, helium was found on the sun. Helium's an inert gas. They didn't really know about it because it doesn't connect with anything. When this helium leaves the balloon, where's it going? Up, and it actually goes to outer space. It reaches escape velocity and leaves the planet. Helium also comes from caves underground. Did you know that? Mostly in the United States. Because if it's out in the atmosphere, it's just going to float away. So they actually get it from caverns underground. Where's my lighter? Oh, good deal. So it acts kind of odd. Now, this is expensive stuff. It's actually getting more expensive every day. But why don't they give you the other gas that floats so much better, called hydrogen? Does anybody want to see that? I figured that. So, if I go ahead and just light these matches.
Lights? Oh, which one are you going to do first?
Oh, I'm going to do the helium first.
Okay.
And I'm going to lift this up, and I'm going to put it right next to this helium balloon, and everybody's so scared of popping balloons, aren't they? Yeah. Look at everybody. Yes, it will. Yes, it will. However, these may act just a little bit different than the other balloons. You tell me why they don't bring you hydrogen balloons to the house when you have a birthday. Ready? Got it? There you go. Turn on clear screen. Good. Okay, you ready? And the matches are still going.
You want to do the laser? Laser balloons?
No. Okay. We'll leave that in.
Okay.
What we will do.
Oh, wait a second. Wait. Let me just say one word.
Let me come back. Yes, everybody likes an explosion, don't they? Yes. It's a good thing they don't sell you those hydrogen balloons.
If you recall, out in the front before the lecture, they did the bowling balls demonstration where you took two bowling balls, both of which had the same weight, which one of which was bigger than the other, and so its density of the smaller one was higher and it sinks, and the density of the bigger one was less, and so it floated. You notice that the water moves up, and that the water that's displaced is what pushes up and supports it. Now we can do the Bernoulli effect.
Yeah.
Okay, this one. This is called the Bernoulli effect. And the Bernoulli effect, the air rushes by very quickly on one side of the balloon, on one side of an object. And it creates a low pressure where the air is moving fast. And you can even tip it like this. And then bring it on back. This is the Bernoulli effect. It's the same thing that makes airplanes fly. And now Dave has one here that you can even use the Bernoulli effect that will pull something in.
The whole roll. I think we should do the whole roll. What do you think?
Yeah.
It's a big roll. You could do a lot of trees with this.
I can't believe it. People wonder why we use so much toilet paper in the physics department. They think they know, but now you know the real reason.
What were those balloons floating in?
Air.
Air. And that air is all around us, isn't it? And that air is fairly dense. Did you know that? Air is actually really, 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 really heavy. If you go to the top of K2 or Everest, you're going to realize that. Go to outer space, you're going to realize that, because without there, you're going to know it. But what we have right here is what? A steel drum. If we take this steel drum and we have a vacuum pump connected to it, we're going to take out all the air from the steel drum. Now that means that right now the air is pushing from the inside of the steel drum on the outside. So it's counterbalancing all the force of the air on it. But if we take the air out of the inside of the steel drum, what's going to happen to it? We don't know when it's going to happen. We don't know how loud it's going to be. We don't know how violent it's going to be. So I hope you all have extra underwear over here. Because we're going to turn this on. You see we have a vacuum pump right here. And it's going to slowly go down. And we'll see what happens to our drum.
We'll just let that cook a little.
Don't worry.
Don't worry about it. Forget about it. I want you to notice up here I have a simulation of a very high temperature gas, molecules running around at high here, and this is a very low temperature gas. Now, what's the difference between the atoms and this gas? What about this gas? Compare these to these.
I think Mark needs some new underwear.
Yeah.
So what did we see happen to our drum? It crushed in a nice violent way. The steel is actually very, very strong. But the atmosphere is that much heavier. Okay? We only took about half the atmosphere out of this, and it already popped on us. If I kept sucking the air out of this, it would get smaller and smaller and smaller, just like the one we had on the stairs. That's how heavy the atmosphere is. So that's a kind of fun experiment, just to experience that.
Okay, this is something I want you to remember when you go out, when you leave here. This is some real physics. Okay, what's the difference between the atoms here and here? What's happening here? Describe them. It's hotter? What is individual atoms doing? They go fast, that's right. These atoms are going very, very fast. And so they have a lot of energy of motion. And that's why they have a high temperature. And look over here. They're going very slowly. They have a low energy of motion. So that's the meaning of temperature. Temperature means in a gas, if it's a high energy of motion, it's a high temperature. If it's a low energy of motion, it's a low temperature. Look what happens to the wall. They bounce off the wall, and this one has a high pressure. They bounce off the wall, and they don't push on the wall, and this one has a low pressure. That's exactly what happened with the can that Dave crushed. It had atoms hitting from both sides until he pulled the atoms out of the inside, and then they were only hitting from the outside, and they crushed it. This is a way of thinking about temperature that is actually very fundamental, and this is the way I want you to think about temperature. High energy of motion, high temperature, low energy of motion. And then we, nitrogen now, right?
Yeah.
And it doesn't go away. Okay, here I have some liquid nitrogen. And here I have a helium balloon. And this helium balloon, if I let go of it, would float up to the ceiling because it has a density that's less than that of air. But if I put it in liquid nitrogen, the atoms that are running around here fast now will start slowing down. They'll hit the walls less hard. There's less energy of motion. It'll push on the walls less, and the balloon will start shrinking, and it will become more dense. And eventually it will get so dense that it will be heavier than air, and it will no longer float. And I'll be able to release it, and it will fall to the floor. But now watch it. They start heating up again, moving faster, hitting the walls, the density decreases, and it floats again. You just wait long enough. I didn't. It stays there. Okay, I've got some other things here to put in the liquid nitrogen. Here are some nice, gentle, nice flowers. And I can put them in here. And they will get so cold, they will turn brittle like glass. Let me just let them cook here. And now they should be as brittle as glass. By the way, liquid nitrogen is 380 degrees Fahrenheit below room temperature and can be very dangerous. So I'll now put the gloves on for this next one. Here I have some everyday stuff. This is just for fun. Here I have some everyday things.
Broccoli.
There's some broccoli. Don't pick up any if it's on the floor because it will be very cold. It could burn your fingers. Here's a hot dog. Or rather, it's a cold dog. And here is a banana. That's a banana. What's that? A banana split. Okay.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So liquid nitrogen is very cold. We use it here for these demonstrations. We did that one already, right? You want to do
that?
Another one?
You did a flower?
Yeah, I did a flower
good,
already.
Good. Then we're all done. We have this over here for you, too.
The nitrogen cannon?
Yeah.
Oh, this one I like. This is liquid nitrogen. It's in a liquid state. And so when it turns into a gaseous state, it gets much larger volume, tremendously larger volume. And so if I put some in here, you want to put it in? Okay, I think that's enough. And now I cork it up, all that gas that's trying to get out can't get out, so what does it do? That's why we call it the liquid nitrogen cannon. Okay.
No. You're out of juice.
Yeah, I'm out of juice. Okay, one last one.
I don't know.
We must have developed a leak. Okay, we did it twice. This demonstration always reminds me of my father. My father used to work in a nitroglycerin factory here in New Jersey in his youth. And when he first got his job, they brought him into his chemistry laboratory. And he noticed that it had three strong brick walls and then a very weak wooden wall. And he asked, what's that? They said, that's the blowout wall. That's because if you make a mistake and everything blows up, it blows out that wall, then they come along and they build a new wall, they clean up all the glass, they hire a new guy, and they go on with their work. But if you're going to work in an explosives factory, you better make sure there's a blowout wall in your room because some of the energy of the explosion goes out that wall and it helps to save your life. I even heard of a story here from New Jersey also where there was a well in the center of the room. And if you were pouring chemicals and you said, oh, expletive deleted, and you throw it down the well, and then you dive for the window, and the window was on cantilevers. And you go out the window, and the explosion would come roaring out the window after you.
Is he doing that right now on the computer?
That's chemistry. That's really exciting. Which one have we got?
Now we're getting to electricity and magnetism. And remember, we had that single filament light bulb before. Right? It's a nice little light bulb. And all you're doing is you're taking the wall power and you're passing it back and forth across a piece of tungsten. You have it inside a vacuum so that it doesn't start on the fire. What's that? No, it's not. It's a light bulb. Because if I go ahead and I put this right across here like that, and now if I put that current into the pickle, just like we put it into the light bulb before, as the power goes back and forth across the pickle, yes, we get, let there be light. Let there be pickle light.
You gotta switch the...
That's exactly what there is. This is now acting the same way. You can turn them all down. You can go ahead, turn them all down. There you go. This is acting the same way that we had that filament in the light bulb before. In fact, if you look at it with your diffraction grating glasses now, it's actually a little sodium color because we're getting that those ions, all that salty fluid that was sitting in the brine is actually what's giving us that color, that yellow color. Okay, so that's a pickle light. With all the budget cuts at Rutgers, that's what we're using, except at the stadium. But that's a whole other story.
Okay. We're going to do the electrons now?
Yeah. No.
Is this intensity up? It's not
you,
on?
You could. Well, this. Oh, you want to do this one first? Oh,
okay, well, either one.
Let's do this one.
Okay. This is the Faraday lecture. Michael Faraday in the early 1820s started lectures for children at Christmas time, and that's why we named the lecture after him. And one of the effects that he observed was the Faraday effect, where magnetic fields can be changed into electrical currents. But the trick was you have to have a changing magnetic field. If I just put a magnet sitting at rest inside of the coil, I get no electricity flowing around the coil. But if I change the magnetic field inside, can you see on the screen up there? It gives me a burst of current. And if I flip it back and forth like a paddle wheel in a generator, I get alternating current. So the changing magnetic field is the thing that makes electricity flow in a circle. And that's the Faraday effect. Actually, we have here an illustration.
Let's actually move right over to here, and now we'll do this one.
Okay.
Let's just do this, your TV.
This is a very nice TV that used to be my wife's TV. I have subsequently had to buy her another television. That's the main thing you should remember
Scanning.
About this particular demonstration. With an old-style TV, there is an electron gun that shoots electrons towards the front. And when the electrons try to run across the magnetic field, they get bent to the side. But when they run down the magnetic field, they go straight. So this ends up concentrating and bending the magnetic field lines. And it's really very beautiful, but it ends up giving you a burnt-out spot in the middle of your screen. All right, so if you do this, you better be ready to buy that television.
Is that burnt-out spot right there, right? Don't do that at home.
Yes.
Don't do that at home.
I did that with my mother's TV, and it then became my TV. It's the second time I've done that. That's one of the prices of being a physicist.
Let's go back to this.
Okay, here we have a capacitor. Now, the thing I want you to notice here is that we're building up electronic charge that are pluses and minuses, and they want to get together and give you back energy. All atoms are made up of plus and minus charges. You separate out the electrons, and it takes a lot of energy when they run back together. And this is now slowly building up energy. You ready to go?
Yeah, pretty much.
Can we move it back a little?
Nah, we're okay.
All right, I'll stand here. All right, and now what I'm going to do is just going to make a bang and a pop. Well, first of all, what I'm going to do is I'm going to unplug the entire thing. I'm going to turn it off, but the energy is still stored there. Turn off the lights. And when I short circuit it, the energy comes out at once.
Okay, you're attached.
Turn on the light. Yep, let that be a lesson to you that you don't go poking around the back of one of these kind of televisions. They have big capacitors in them. Okay? And so you watch out. You stay away from the back of old electron tube TVs.
This
okay,
one?
Okay, this is the first one, right?
Okay, let's do that first.
You don't want to do this one, or you want me to?
Why don't you go ahead?
Okay,
where's
the magnet? Ah. Okay, this is also going to be induced currents by changing magnetic fields. This is a neodymium iron boron magnet, something that no child should ever handle. Okay, they can shatter, pieces can get ingested and tear up the insides of you. Let's be clear about this. Don't fool around with neodymium iron boron magnets. You can also get pinched against things very badly. But they have beautiful, strong magnetic fields. They were invented by General Motors for small motors. And now I'm going to drop it down a copper tube, a very thick copper tube. So as the magnetic field changes at a given height in this tube, electricity flows. And that energy for the electricity comes from the falling of this guy, and he floats his way down the tube. It's a big effect. By the way, Tim Koth gave us this. It was from Fermilab. And it's a piece of wire. It's a piece of electrical wire. They carried so much energy in this wire that they had to send water through the center to cool it, or else it would have melted on them. You couldn't cool it from the outside. This is the same thing. An object flows down, slides down an inclined plane, and you notice that it goes down slowly because it's a neodymium iron boron magnet on a copper. The other thing I want you to notice is it doesn't fall off. You don't have to be particularly tricky to make it stay. That's because whenever it goes to the corner, the changing magnetic field as it rolls is in the air. And that's like paddling a boat in the air. And the side that's in the metal is scooping electrons, so it always steers itself back to the center because that's where the electrons are being forced to move. Let me put this away.
I got that.
You got? Okay. Now we have the illustrations of this same effect in a more emotional sense. Here's a powerful magnet. I roll an object down an inclined plane, and when it hits the magnet, the changing magnetic fields make electricity flow and it slows down. It's like hitting butter. Here I have another object which has had the center cut out, but still has a path for electricity to go around in a circle. And I roll it down in the inclined plane.
Come on back.
I roll it down the inclined plane, and it shows the full effect. And then finally, I've got this guy. You can't see him very well, but he's cut from this side, this side, this side, so that no electricity can flow in a circle. Almost nothing's gone except nothing can flow in a circle, and he goes through as if it isn't there. Okay, so it's electricity that's flowing in a circle that matters.
It's the magnet.
Now there's a cute thing we can do with that. Here I have a coil that if I send electricity through it, becomes a magnet.
You have a little ball here.
Okay. Okay, if I put him here, he sticks, I turn it off, and he comes off easily. And if I put a solid circle on here, then I get changing magnetic fields in here because this is hooked up to an AC circuit and the magnetic field flips direction 60 times a second. And this one's actually quite fun because it's called the ring flinger. Actually, I used to have kids come up and I'd say, here, put this on here like this, and then I would turn it on and the poor child would go like this. And then, of course, I turn it off. I'd say, no, put it on like this. The legal department has suggested I stop doing that. And then here is one with a notch cut out of it. Nothing can flow in a circle, so it doesn't show the effect, because of course, but of course then the children don't trust me by that time. And so I have to show you that the other one jumps at the same time this one does not jump. And then finally, we've got, we're ready for this one?
Yeah.
Finally, okay. If we cool it to liquid nitrogen temperature, it goes, it has the electricity flow much more easily because the conductivity of aluminum is larger, and it works on steroids. Okay. You got to do this one down the incline plane?
Yeah, let's go.
Oh, wait. Let me move the one on the other side. Oh, I don't have to hurry.
I don't have to hurry.
There's no hurry. Boom.
So this was also cooling in the liquid nitrogen, and look how much more that effect is right now. That a current is that much more efficient inside there. It's a lot slower. Okay, remember, this is exactly the reverse effect of this. In this one, the magnet moved through the copper. In this one, the copper and aluminum are moving through the magnet, yet the effect is identical. Okay? What happens is they get the moving flux lines, and that's what gives us this effect. It's a secret to our world. You want to do the transformer?
Oh, yes, of course. I forgot the last step.
That's why it's a secret.
Yes. The last step on this one is how do I know it's electricity flowing in a circle? And the way is I couple the two through with a, I put a light bulb across the gap in something like this, and I light a light bulb with the induced currents. They're connected through thin air, but through the changing magnetic field in the loop.
Now, Mark's had a long show, so he's really tired, so we gave him a bed to lie down on. That's right. Just a little bed. We'll even give him a pillow for his head. Okay. And for this particular demonstration, what we need are a couple volunteers. And I don't see any here. There seems to be nobody here who really wants to volunteer for anything. Come on down. And... you, in the pink. Yeah, come on down. Your name, sir?
Philip.
Philip's going to help us out. Your name, ma'am?
Nicole.
I actually was picking her, but that's okay. Well, next time.
Okay, Philip and Nicole, get on the bed of nails now.
Yeah. Just stay back over here. Come back over here. Mark is lying down on a bed of nails. These are real nails. We went to Home Depot and bought some nails. You two just stay right there. Okay.
I'll hold it out to the side.
There you go. We'll put that to the side. We'll hear his screams anyway, even without the microphone. So now we have a second bed of nails we're going to put on top of him. Not too close to his chin. There we go. Now what we need you two to do, come on over here, and gently, very gently, you're going to get on top of Mark.
No dancing, no jumping.
There you go. So now Mark has the weight of two children sitting on top of him while he lies between a bed of nails. You're okay, Mark, right?
Oh, I'm great.
I'll lift you up and down. There we go. Fantastic. Big round of applause for our volunteers. Thank you so much. Now, Mark, no, stay right there. Thank you.
Oh, yeah?
Thank you so much. You can back up. There you go. Yeah, you stay there. We have one we worked on, a demonstration that Mark hasn't seen before. Hey, what's that say?
Physics,
because it's all about physics, isn't it? Yeah. We'll put that, yeah, it looks just like a guillotine, doesn't it? Just like that. Right here, Mark, this is just a brick. Don't worry about that.
I know. Dave,
no, don't worry about that.
You were my student, right? We can
renegotiate.
And
what we got here is what? A sledgehammer. Don't tell them. Because our experiment now is sledgehammer, brick, professor. Bed of nails. Does Mark live? And many people have argued about that. All right, now, actually, when I was a student here, Mark was one of my professors, and he gave me a lousy grade.
We can talk about that.
Too late. We need a count of three. One, two, three. Now let's take a look at that piece. This is all about science. This whole show is all about science, isn't it? We don't want to give this as some kind of trick, as some kind of Swami thing. We want to talk about why he's okay. Well, relatively okay. Okay? This is very similar to Mark. It's a balloon. That's right. Thin skin and filled with hot air. Here's a bed of nails. Here's another bed of nails. Here's another bed of nails. What's the difference? How many more nails does this have than this one, than this one? Right, the density of nails is much higher here than here than here. So if Mark lies on a bed of nails, and we'll say, we'll be nice. We'll say he weighs about 200 pounds. Okay? And Mark lies on a bed of nails, but it only has one nail. How many pounds per nail? 200. That's a lot of force. Let's say he has 10 nails on his bed of nails. How many pounds per nail? Let's say he has 100 nails on his bed of nails. How many pounds per nail? Let's say he has 1,000 nails on his bed of nails. How many pounds per nail? 0.2. So the more nails, the less force per nail you actually need. We found this out. 13 pounds of pressure on a nail to go through human skin. It was a very bad day. But we found this out. Okay, you need about 13 pounds. But will the balloon here now break on that bed of nails? Because there's so many nails, there's not enough force to get through there. How about here? What do you think? Because I know you're all scared of popping balloons. No. How about here? Because it's the last one, right? You know it's the last one. It's got to work. And you would be right. Now, since you're all beginners, anybody ready? Start with one. No, just kidding. Don't do it, okay? Just kidding.
Okay.
Mark's got one last demo.
I want to finish up with a demo I first saw my college professor do in chemistry. This is classified as an extremely dangerous demonstration. I've done it lots of times, and it'll be okay. The reason I can do it is because liquid nitrogen is 380 degrees Fahrenheit above the temperature of me, and it boils very quickly, and I have saliva in my mouth that takes a little while to freeze. That being said, I'm going to step off camera because I don't want this posted to the internet. I should be the last person on Earth doing this experiment. We call it the dragging experiment, so let me step off camera, and this is liquid nitrogen. As I said, I should be the last person in the world doing that experiment.
Hey, thank you so much. Spending your Friday night with us. We really feel honored that you would spend your time with us. We really appreciate it. Have yourself a great holiday, okay? Thank these wonderful people right here. Right. Mark. Have a great holiday, okay? Enjoy yourselves. Don't touch anything down here.
Okay.